Good morning.
At the outset, let me thank Dr. Hitesh and Professor Johari for giving me this opportunity. My topic is distal radial fractures. Distal radial fractures, you have to know something about the surgical anatomy. So this is the lower end of radius as a metaphyseal flare. It has three concave articular fossas, that is the scaphoid fossa, lunate fossa and the sigmoid fossa. And if you look at the thickness of the cortex, the dorsal and the lateral cortices are usually thin. And this is the reason why usually these fractures displace into lateral side and the dorsal side. Another important anatomical point you have to know is a watershed line. And this is the most volar projection of the distal radius. Here you can see the pronator quadratus. So the pronator quadratus is not covering this portion. So if you put an implant there, what will happen is it may irritate the soft tissues like median nerve and the flexor tendons. So you should not place the plate too distally. It may lead to irritation of the soft tissue. The volar ulnar corner of the distal radius is considered as the keystone to the distal radius. And this is because this is the strongest part of bone. And it supports the lunate facet, and it gives attachment to the volar ligaments. Biomechanically, the distal radius is considered as having three columns, the radial, intermediate, and the ulnar column. They are composed of different components, and they are subjected to different types of mechanical forces. The radial column is formed by the scaphoid fossa and the styloid. The ulnar column is formed by the ulna and the TFCC, and the intermediate column is formed by the lunate facet. Coming to the epidemiology, 1/6 of all fractures seen in the casualty is a distal radius fracture. There is a trimodal distribution: pediatric, women after 40 years, and males up to 50 years. And this is the most common osteoporotic fracture. There are various methods to classify. Gartland and Worley were the first person to classify in 1951. Then there were various classifications. Another important classification is the Mellon classification. Here he has classified the fractures into, depending upon the involvement of various fragments. There are four fragments. One is the radial shaft, second is the radial styloid, third is the volar ulnar corner, and the fourth is the dorsal ulnar corner. So depending upon the type of involvement, there are different types. This is one of the most popular classifications, that is the Fernandez and Jupiter classification, which was published in 1993. It depends upon the type of forces that produce the fracture. It can either be bending type of force. Second, it may be a shear fracture, something similar to the Barton fractures, or it may be a compression fracture involving the distal articular surface leading to comminution, or it may be a hemorrhage fracture, which is a fracture dislocation. And lastly, it may be a high energy fracture where there is associated large amount of soft tissue trauma. Coming to the treatment, treatment depends upon the patient factors, the fracture personality, and the associated injuries. The patient factors to consider is age, functional needs of the patient, occupation, and the handedness. The fracture personality is understood by asking these questions. Is the fracture displaced or undisplaced? Is the fracture intra-articular or extra-articular? Is it reducible or irreducible? Or is it stable or unstable? In an intra-articular fracture, usually you need to restore the articular congruity. In an extra-articular fracture, usually you have to correct the alignment. Non-operative treatment or operative treatment can be done depending upon the assessment of the patient. Non-operative treatment is indicated in patients who are having undisplaced fractures and reducible and stable fractures. These patients are usually treated by a short-arm cast for 4 to 6 weeks. But important thing is you should take weekly x-rays to rule out any re-displacement. In elderly patients and those with less stable fractures, a longer period of embolization may be required. Ideal non-operative treatment should produce satisfactory reduction, and it should maintain the reduction till the fracture unites. But problem with non-operative treatment is there is difficulty in reduction of intra-articular fragments and there is inadequate axial stability. Reduction can be done in all patients, even if straight away you think this patient needs surgery, still such patient should be having an attempted reduction. This is because it will reduce the pain and it will relieve the pressure on the soft tissue structures. Another important thing is if you take another X-ray after reduction, it will your assessment of the fracture geometry will be much better. Method of reduction is by traction. Then once traction is given, then an anterior directed pressure is required to correct the dorsal angulation. And if the volar cortex is also displaced, then usually the deformity has to be exaggerated so that you can unlock the fracture fragments. Once the fracture is reduced, you have to take a check X-ray, and on the check X-ray you have to assess the reduction. Reduction is assessed by measuring the following measurements. One is the radial inclination. This is measured by drawing the longitudinal axis of the radius. Then you have to draw a perpendicular to that line, and then one more line is drawn along the articular surface of the radius. Normal, it is about 22 degrees. A similar kind of line is drawn on the lateral view. Again, a perpendicular is drawn. Then another line is drawn parallel to the articular surface, and the angle should be ideally be 11. So this is the palmar tilt, and this is the radial inclination. There are two types of lengths you can measure. One is the radial length, and second is the ulnar variance. Here, in radial length, again the axis is drawn. Then a line is drawn at the ulnar corner. Another line is drawn at the tip of the radial styloid, and this distance is the, in millimeters is the radial length. It should be ideally be 11. Ulnar variance is measured in this fashion. Then one more angle is the carpal alignment. Here an axis of the capitate is drawn, then the axis of the radius is drawn, and the angle, the apex of the angle should be usually crossing at the inside the carpus. If it is crossing outside the carpus, there is carpal malalignment. Acceptable reduction is 15 degree dorsal and 20 degree palmar tilt, 15 degree radial inclination, less than 5 millimeters of radial shortening, and ulnar variance should be either negative or neutral. And articular gap should be less than 2 millimeters, and the articular step should be less than 1 millimeter. Next thing to assess is whether the reduction is stable. This is assessed by Lafontaine criteria. This is dorsal angulation less than 20, dorsal comminution more than 50, palmar comminution and initial displacement more than 1 centimeter, initial radial shortening of more than 5 millimeters. All these are considered to be signs of instability, and such patients usually should be treated by surgery. Indication for surgery are irreducible fractures, fractures with predicted or proven instability depending upon the Lafontaine criteria, bilateral fractures, and polytrauma. Operative options are percutaneous pinning, external fixation, internal fixation, or a combination. Percutaneous pinning is indicated in young patients with reduced or irreducible fractures with instability. Contraindication for pinning are severe intra-articular comminution, elderly osteoporotics, and along with plates, because this may lead to infection. Types of pinning can be extrafocal or intrafocal. Intrafocal pinning is done through the fracture site. The aim of pinning is to provide stability and to avoid injury to the nerves and the tendons. There are various types of external focal pinning, and the most stable type of pinning is the two parallel transstyloid pins associated with the third wire through the dorsal ulnar corner. Intrafocal pinning was described by Capangi in 1976. There are two dorsal K-wires that are put through the fracture site, and these are used to buttress the dorsal cortex. There are various modifications, and the present evidence says that there is a higher degree of complications associated with Capangi type of pinning. outcome of pinning usually depends upon the age of the patient. It is well suited for young patients with reducible or reducible intra-articular or extra-articular fractures. Pinning in comminuted fractures is usually not indicated. In such patients, ideally it should be treated by a combined external fixation. Can you give me 2 more minutes, sir?
Yeah.
Types of external fixator can be bridging or non-bridging, or it may be dynamic or static. The pin insertion technique is the most important one. You should not put a percutaneous pin because there is a high chance of tendon or nerve injury, or you may lead to extended drilling, which may later lead to fractures. And pin should be inserted by limited open technique. Limited open technique is 2 small incisions, 2.5 centimeters. One is 10 centimeter above the radial styloid, and second is over the dorsolateral aspect of the index metacarpal. And the proximal pin should engage the third metacarpal also. The amount of ligamentotaxis that you see in the postoperative X-ray, there should be 1 millimeter of widening of the radiocarpal joint. In this X-ray, you can see that there is over destruction. Pin size should be 3.5 millimeters for the radius and 2.5 millimeters for the metacarpals. Ideal fixator should be radiolucent. It should allow independent positioning of the pins, and if the patient needs another attempt at reduction, it should allow. And it should allow joint motion. And the current evidence is published in the Cochrane Review in 2008. There are 9 trials, 510 patients with 5 comparison groups, and what it showed is there is more incidence of serious complications in those patients who are treated by external fixation. And at present, there is insufficient evidence for bridging versus non-bridging, and insufficient evidence for dynamic versus static fixation. Open reduction and plating is indicated in those patients who are having intra-articular fractures. You can go for dorsal or volar, but at present nobody is doing dorsal plating. Volar plating is done by extended flexor carpi radialis approach. Here you can see the yellowish watershed line, and this is the pronator quadratus distal attachment. And if you elevate the pronator quadratus through this area, which is 2 millimeter distal to the attachment, then the repair is much more easier. And in those patients who are having complex fractures, you may need to expose the dorsal side. So this can be done in this fashion. You can cut the brachioradialis, then rotate the shaft fragment in this fashion. And after that, you can expose. Volar plating, there are various types of plates available.
Please be fast.
And present FAD is variable angle distal fixation. So this allows an independent trajectory for these screws, and it matches the anatomy. But it is more prominent and can produce soft tissue problems. And the present upcoming topic is the fragment specific fixation. And this allows placement of implants in the orthogonal planes, and individual fragments can be reduced. In short, this is one of the most happening areas of fracture treatment. There are plenty of options available. You should know the criteria for acceptable reduction, and you should know the criteria for predicted instability. And at present, even though there are various options available, the level of evidence that is available is still poor. Thank you.